good afternoon, gentlemen.
Bobby!
Remy.
What's up, man?
Ed, and for anyone who will watch this, number one fan, and I would say super fan of the show, Jamie Stew.
Jamie Stew,
welcome onto the podcast.
I've never heard of this show before in my life.
Oh, lies. He was the first even person that we got on Twitter. He said, welcome to the Twitterverse. I just checked it out.
Yeah. No, I love Bobby and Remy. These are my guys.
So, what's going on with you?
Let's introduce Jamie.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's part of it.
Jamie, we're like the terrible threesome. We all work together. We talk to you about when we work with children. He was also one of the staff that was there. And Jamie's just an interesting motherfucker, man. We've been trying to get this dude on for about 3 years. Never worked out. And he's here. And he's being suspiciously quiet.
So from my standpoint, Jamie, you and I have ever talked about it, but the whole point that we wanted to do this podcast was for people our age, just because we have a unique kind of experience in life, and a lot of us just have unique experiences. And like Remy was saying, you're no different. And that's, thank you for coming on.
Thanks.
And the way I kind of view it, I don't know about you, Rem, is we view it kind of like it goes wherever it goes. And that's okay. Like, you know, like we don't like to do really like scripted stuff because to us, it's kind of like that's boring. So it's whatever you want to talk about yourself or about your life experiences.
How perfect.
One thing I remember about all of us working together, by the way, the gallon water jug you would always bring in.
All right. I have 4 gallons of water in the car. I really? Just tried to grab a gallon out of the back of my truck, but it was too close to the car park next to me.
That's fine.
No. So if we take a break, this might be replaced.
No, that's fine.
He understands the power of hydration.
Yeah.
I like to pee. Yeah. You know, sometimes if you hold in a pee long enough, right?
It'll feel real good.
Goosebumps.
Yes.
And it's like it's wonderful. It's really satisfying.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So yeah, for me, you caught me at a perfect time. Just sold my house, getting a divorce. My wife has a boyfriend. Fucking awesome, dude. I have so much to talk about. Shout out to you. You know who you are.
The Zennial Odyssey Podcast, where we discuss life from the point of view of people born in the late 1970s to the early to mid 1980s. We discuss growing up analog and navigating adulthood in a digital world. Please come join us as we look to uncover what it actually means to be a Zennial.
By the way, thank you for bringing that up, but I always leave it up to you. Like, you direct wherever it goes. I would never make anyone talk about anything they don't want to, but...
Listen, I'm at peace with the whole situation, okay. So I'm going to make a lot of light of this and make jokes.
Okay.
Yeah. Isn't going to be like therapy.
I wish I could do the same thing because I just got fired from my job.
Let's go.
I wish I could do the same thing. I'm just not at that point where I can make light about it.
I have a crazy got fired story, too, coming up in a little bit.
Okay.
But yeah, man, this has been exciting. We're just going to kind of powwow. We're going to see what happens. So we started this day really interesting today. If you mind me sharing?
Please.
Jamie's like, yo, man, you want to go to church with me? And I was like, yeah. Yeah. And I know that might seem strange to people who know me because I'm just sort of like this free-floating thing.
When was the last time you ever went to church, Rob?
Dude, while I was sitting there, right, I was like, when I got confirmed, mm-hmm. I was 14 and I had like taken like a course to get confirmed and stuff. And I think I had done a couple Christmas masses between those, but it's been a long time.
Can I interrupt for 1 second?
Please.
What was your confirmation name? Do you remember?
Oh my God. My mom would.
You don't, I remember mine.
What was yours?
It was Andrew.
I was Jeremiah.
Jeremiah. Nicely done. Yeah, going biblical right there.
Fuck, yeah. I totally forgot that was a thing. What's that about? Why did they change your name?
A lot of the apostles, and they changed their names. Like Saul, after he like gave his life to the Lord, he became Paul. Even today, in the message, they were talking about this guy, John. He was like also known as Mark.
So that's kind of cool, like rappers.
Yeah. Some Jamie, a.k.a. Jeremiah.
Yeah.
The fucking bullfrog.
Your street name versus your God name.
So in that regard, Remy, whatever it was, you became the artist formerly known as Remy.
For yeah.
It's probably like Damien or something. let's be real here.
That's fucking great.
Fucking omen.
Yeah, come on, dude.
it had been a while, but I mean, it was just, you know, there's been some interesting thing happening.
You had an interesting occurrence occur.
Yeah. You remember how I got fired and we were talking about it?
Yeah.
So I get a call this week from the woman who fired me. And I'm like, am I in more trouble? Like, well, what is this about? I answer the phone. And she's like, hey, we'd like you to come in for another position. Like, and I was like, am I getting punked right now? Is this some, like, is this one of my friends fucking with me? You know what I mean? I had to make sure the number was, like, legit on the front of the phone. And I was like, yeah, I'm going in Tuesday to do an interview with the place that fired me.
Interesting.
So that happened, you know, but it felt like, because I loved the job, dude. And I mean, you can't fight customers, you know, when it comes down to it, it makes sense that I would have been in some kind of trouble. But this is unprecedented, dude. This is crazy to have the lady who fired me call me and be like, I think you should come back in. And I was like, all right, I'll do it.
I'm not going to lie. In my situation, I'm pretty sure if they call me, it's not to bring me back. It's because they're trying to gather information for a
client. You'd said that to me. Like, Rem, I don't think our stories are going to play out the exact same way.
I know
you
said we're very in tune, but this is somewhere where we have gone on different paths.
No, I jarred. And trust me, the lane I'm in is very weird, dude. This is a new precedent for the company that fired you to call you back and be like, hey. And she was like, you were too good for that position and we limited you. And in this new position, you'll just kind of be at your own whim. And I'm like, turn me loose.
Wow. You mean an employer who actually says, hey, you were too good and we set you up to fail. We want to make amends.
I love them. I'm not going to say anything bad.
Okay.
But it's a trip to have that happen. Mm-hmm. It's a trip to have that happen. So I felt like there were good things happening. And he asked me, and I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna go to God's house and thank him today.
That's really nice. I actually, the way you just, like, spun that, too, I like that.
That was it. I was very grateful, and I was talking to him a lot and shit, and so he asked me.
Giving thanks to a higher power.
Yeah. Yeah, because something was involved with this complete 360, and I just want to be grateful. I don't want the universe to know I am. So we did that. Yeah, yeah. I mean, talk about it. Like, the beginning of it is, like, a jam session. There's, like, four people playing music. And, like, it was cool, man, because everybody, and he told me before he went in, he's like, listen, everybody worships differently. So you'll see some of this, 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 right? Yeah,
yeah. Jamie, if don't mind me asking, is it like a non-denominal type of church?
No, it's straight up evangelical.
Oh, okay, all right. I only ask because I've never, like, my experience is just like Roman Catholic and a little bit of Jehovah Witness, and I know the difference is like that. But I remember, like, when the place we worked at, we would actually have them go to, like, non-denominal churches just to kind of cover everything. I wasn't sure. That's all.
The problem is right now with religion is for most people who are, like, secular or not, you know, like, really walking with their faith is that you hear evangelical Christianity, and you think, like, Trump flags waving. It's not like that. It's all older people, actually. It's a very small church. It's like 20 people that go. I know the pastor. But it's nothing like that. And so, like, I always have to preface it because it's like I'll tell people I'm going to church. Mm-hmm. And they're like, whoa, where's your KKK flag? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And it's like, it's not like that. It's really a cool, safe place to go. And it's accepting of everybody. And it's really helped me because I have had some trying times these last few months, especially. And when you're at your darkest moments, you need to be it. You can't do it on your own.
I'm glad you brought it up that way, Jamie, in all honesty, because like my wife, her parents are Jehovah Witnesses.
Yeah.
So they converted when she was 16 years old. Mm-hmm. So she was raised Roman Catholic until the age of 16. Wow. And then it was kind of like a, well, this is what is expected, but she was a teenager, so it was a little...
Like, turns you off.
Yeah, but her father has kind of grown in the congregation. He's an elder now, and I actually went to when they kind of did a coronation for him. And, you know, it was good because then they had a party afterwards, and that's a big... They only do parties when it's a big deal. And what he did is a big deal.
Yeah.
And they were... There was celebrating, there was beer drinking, but what I liked about it is it wasn't like people rage. It was just people just socially drinking and talking about scripture and things, and it blew my mind out of the stereotype of, like, these are the people that go door to door and do this stuff, and they're just we're all people.
The thing with that is part of that is acts of service,
mm-hmm.
and it helps you with humility. It helps you keep yourself centered. Mm-hmm. It takes the onus of living our lives through our will and through ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
So that's that door-to-door stuff. But the biggest thing with being into my faith and into religion as an adult is it's of my own choice, mm-hmm. and the fellowship of it. You surround yourself with like-minded people, whether that be people who like to fish, people who like to go to church, people who like to go out drinking in bars. Mm-hmm. And it's like you surround yourself with like-minded people, and who you want to be, that's what you do. So for me right now, going through a huge transition in my life, to keep me from falling off a cliff, it's I have to be around positive people. I have to be around loving people. And you will find that in a church. You don't have to be a literalist. You don't have to just read the Bible and be like, dude, this guy lived for 700 years. Like, come on, man. So it's like, it's more so finding a center for yourself. Some people find that through meditation. Mm-hmm. Some people find that through Buddhism. Some people find that through hiking in a mountain, sitting ocean seaside on a sandy beach. Whatever finds you in a positive way, finding your center, mm-hmm. that's where it's at. And that's how you, especially in times of trials and tribulations, from really falling off a cliff.
Do you find as you've, because we're all relatively the same age.
So 42, 1982, Capricorn.
Yep,
ladies, single, just sold my house. I have a chunk of change in my pocket. All right, I lost some weight. I got a new truck. Man, come holla at you. Jamie Stewart.
I love right, that.
Yeah, what's up?
All right.
Anyways, go.
What I was going to ask you is
401-386-4297.
Boom, there it is. So what I was going to ask you is, have you found that as you've gotten older, now this is a big transition, as you already said, but like your kind of like way of life has changed, or it's started to change? Because I noticed that like around like 40.
Yeah, my whole mindset has shifted. You know, I grew old, mm-hmm. but I wasn't growing up.
Ooh! And,
I like the way you put
it. Dang, that was nice, bro.
So like, you know, I had my son when I was, 34, and I had my daughter when I was 38. And after I had my daughter, that really started the shift.
Mm-hmm.
Not saying I didn't love my son any differently, but the responsibility and the love that you receive from a little girl as a man, if that doesn't motivate you to start changing your life and to be a better person, I don't know what could. Maybe that's just particular to me. I struggled though for a few years because I didn't have that center. My spirit was actually getting more broken, and I was going further from the person I wanted to be. You know, I'm not going to get into too much details, but you know, I got, you know, I'm sober now, for a few months, and, you know,
congratulations, brother.
Thank you.
That's good.
Thanks. But good. The thing is, it's,
you look for me.
I kissed my hand, though, guys.
Remy's like a brother to me.
Yeah, family shit, bro.
Anyways, what I found out, though, through that is I didn't have that center.
Mm-hmm.
And to help me really start to become the person I wanted to be, I had to recalibrate every aspect of my life. And, I think part of being in your 40s is, in the grand scheme of things, we're not old,
mm-mm.
but we're definitely not kids anymore.
Mm-mm.
And this is the time.
Buck up or fuck off.
Exactly. You have to make certain changes in your life at this point, because you're not going to change much.
You know what 50, I said to myself? Me and you have had this exact discussion where we've said, yo, that shit we're doing is not cute anymore. Mm-hmm. It's not funny anymore. It's sloppy. Just sad.
yeah, it's sloppy.
We've had those discussions.
Exactly.
Because me and Jamie, what's interesting about our friendship is like, we'll spiral together, but then pull each other out together. Mm-hmm. And then we observed our spiraling. So we're like, yo, we need to be healthier people.
Yeah.
But and that's what it does come down to. I mean, the conversations we have now versus the conversations we used to have, it's night and day. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Because another thing is me and Jamie, and I'll speak for myself more so, in ways made ourselves unavailable. For healing, for growth, we locked it. We locked it behind different things.
I hear you there, because that's what I mean. I mean, I'm trying to transition away from, because like when people are talking to me, like, especially about my situation right now. And it's like, oh, you just seem like you don't care. It's like, no, I bottled it all up inside because that's what I've done my whole fucking life.
Yeah, we're guys.
And I just bottled, yeah, be a man. Yeah, be a man. Yeah. Bottle it up. And what I really, because what I really want, and I'll be raw here, because what I, when people are like, you just act like you don't care. And it's like, well, I'm bottling it up because if I'm not, I'm going to start punching holes through walls and people are going to call the cops.
Or I'm going to start sobbing and people don't know what to do with a crying man. Mm-hmm. No one will hug me.
Yeah.
There's times and places for all of that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But, yeah, it sucks, dude. It's really, it's not the good times where we're tested as men or as adults. Mm. It's during these moments. How are you going to react to that? You know, are you going to, it's okay to wallow, but not for 6 months.
Yeah.
You know, like, and you can wallow and make progress at the same time. I like to wallow in my shit. Mm. I like that feeling, but you can't sit in it for too long.
Yeah, I agree. Although my last like 6 days have felt like 6 months. But
yeah, but you're brand new to where you're at, yeah. and you're in a limbo.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's scary, dude. It's scary.
It's terrifying.
And you have to give yourself some grace. There's no perfect way to move on in any road that you go down, not in specifically professional.
On the one hand, it's passion. It is. I don't think, Jamie, you and I have ever talked about this. Like, I talked to Ray. Like, I still worked at where we worked for another, like, 7-8 years after everybody, okay. you both left.
Yeah.
I climbed all the way up to, like, run one of their programs.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah, yeah. And I was good at it. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not going to lie. Like, you remember how batshit crazy things could get there?
Absolutely.
And, like, how many times you would have to physically manage somebody for safety?
Yeah.
Like, I got the program I ran down to 3 times a year.
Restrains?
18 to 22 year olds.
Violent restraints?
Once every 4 months.
Wow. Wow, good for you, that's, bro.
Hey, honestly, that's
but that's amazing. A kudos to them.
Yeah.
Like, as much as me, yeah, I created a structure where they felt like that.
But the implementation.
Yeah. But then they started using my house. Oh, where are we going to find like the next manager? Where are we going to find the next super? We'll just take it from Bob. Bob's shown Bob can do it all over again.
Yeah.
And like, I just got to a point where I was like, and then like, there was an opening for a position above and I didn't get it. And at that point, I just said, fuck it. And I stayed too long because I was trying to find another job. And then in that situation, that one actually led me into legal trouble because then I did something fucking dumb and I own that. And I had to get a fucking lawyer and just, you know, deal with that. And
that job, the burnout rate, I commend you for making it that long because I was there for less than 2 years. And it was just you need to give a lot to that job.
Too much.
And, you know. Even once you move up from just being line staff, you're still giving a lot.
Yes.
You're like the papa bear of the whole place.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's funny. It's like almost like a coaching tree, right? So you're the head coach. You have this great coaching staff.
And they're going to pick them.
Like, you're taking your offensive coordinator. Oh, you're a special teams guy. And then all of a sudden, it's just you with you're training a whole new staff.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how bad habits
and
happen.
And he's getting punished for being good at the job.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so similar things have happened to me in other places in my career, not to that extreme, but I mean, And really, I'm just at a point where I feel like, you know, like during this time, I am literally, and it's a thought I've had a couple times, but being like, you know, fuck human services. Like, I think I'm just done with human services. Mm-hmm. So,
or a different setting, you know,
old people.
I've worked with old people in my career. Love it.
Yeah, man.
Love it. You brain know, injuries too? You ever work with anyone with brain injuries?
I was an OT for 10 years, bro.
Love them.
I'm the TBI king.
Love them. They're my favorite people that I've worked with.
I was an occupational therapist for 10 years, and you know, I have a special needs son with various neurological impairments, mm-hmm. and it's like I feel like that was my training to like deal with my kid.
Yeah.
You know? Like, cause I'm one of the only people that can understand him.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Like what he's going through, and it's like that was definitely my path at the time led me to that, you know? But, yeah, dude, you know, being in this recovery process that I'm in from my drinking and stuff, dude, even there's a wide open area for people that are compassionate and that are empathetic. Like, and you definitely have those qualities and you can really, there's a lot of new work. It's no longer just the spin dry technique, you mm-hmm. know, there's a lot of therapy involved. There's a lot of holistic treatments and approaches involved to recovery now and a lot of help. And the state of Massachusetts will fund your training and education. And there's a lot of new places popping up, and there's a lot of help that's needed, you know?
I remember it was 2011, and my wife, she wasn't even dating at the time, but she was in her master's program, and she had to go to, like, AA or NA meetings, which, as someone who's not AA or NA, I mean, that's something she struggled with it because that's a very private thing. You're entering something like, so she wanted some help. And so she asked me to go. And so we went, and I won't share what was discussed, but I thought it was like what you just described. It was very, there was no therapist, but it was a therapeutic
environment.
I go to a full disclosure. Yeah. We won't get into too many specifics, but there are different types of meetings and groups. And, you know, you can go to one with 200 people, but you can find some, like the one I'm going to tonight, there's 12 people.
Yeah, that was about the size of one.
It's legit a group therapy session.
Yeah.
We sit around and we help each other through stuff. And there's a thing in recovery that it's, unless you are an addict of something, you know, addiction is an organic brain disorder.
Yeah.
You know, we're not just being sloppy people with poor discipline. This is a spiritual disease, and it's also a physical and mental one as well.
I'm glad you brought that up.
And, you know, it's tough if you don't have someone in your family that's an addict, or if you're not an addict yourself, to truly help these people. So that's why these programs are so important, and the funding for these things are so important, because it truly does help. And there are millions of people at this point that have been helped through this. And so please, guys, have some grace. When you see somebody on the side of the road, I thank God that I didn't have an opioid addiction or, you know, alcoholism is bad anyways. Trust me, it's the worst thing. It'll kill you. But when you see those poor people panhandling and you see someone leaning on the street or see a video of it, don't look at those people in disgust. Look at that through a compassionate lens. And that person's struggling. Nobody wants to be there. Nobody wants to feel that way. Trust me.
Mm.
I can tell you one thing. The last 2 years of my alcohol abuse, it was never for fun. It was never for fun. It was like, the only thing I can akin this to is just being under a spell. And it was terror. And I'm so happy and grateful. And that's why I try to be thankful for life. I'm grateful to my higher power, to everything, because I couldn't do it on my own. I tried many times to stop drinking. I was at a point where I couldn't drink for 24. If I made it 24 hours, I was happy.
Like that was a huge accomplishment.
It was a huge accomplishment. And it's just being able to break free of that and not having the desire and obsession to drink. I never thought it was possible.
What did that Never. Did that feel like? Just that alone, did that feel like just this huge weight?
Every day.
Yeah.
Dude, I just had to move out of my house on my own. Again, I'm going through a divorce.
Yeah.
I work full time. I you know, I'm in a management position, so I'm doing things. And it's like, there's a lot of stress. And I thank God. There's no way I would have been able to get through this if I was still drinking. I would have blew this. And I didn't. I got through it. And you know, like, that builds your confidence and your self-esteem, but it also makes you truly grateful. And that's the only word, you know?
Amen.
Because, God, it sucked, dude. It sucked. And I, you know, you don't realize it until you're in the thick of it, you know? I was always the party animal. Shit, bro. Like, that was my thing, you know? Like, I was never good at throwing a football. Or, you know, I was never a great athlete or the smartest guy. I'm fairly intelligent. But the thing is I was great at drinking beers. I could roll the fattest blunts. Dude, I was, bro, I loved skills, dude. But anyways.
You roll nice blunts.
Yeah. But that was how I identified myself.
Yeah.
And then, again, going back to your behavior at a certain age isn't cool anymore, cute anymore.
Yeah.
So, yeah. 20s, mid-30s.
Dude.
Yeah, dude. Jamie's good for a good time, but now it's like, yeah, you're 42 and you fucking can barely keep your life together. You know what
it's I'm
saying?
A fine,
like, what the fuck are you doing?
It's a fine line. God, nobody's going to get this. Three of you are going to get this. It's a fine line between Shane Gillis and Ari Shaffer. It is. Gillis knows how to have fun with it. Ari Shaffer is a fuck-up doing, like, fucking galaxy gas and shit. There's a line. And then, yeah, like I said, you get to a point where I'm like, oh, yeah. It's not cute anymore. You're just fucked up. Not you. Speaking of myself. But It's crazy. But that's how we were. I mean, you remember, well, we'd all get fucked up.
I remember at one point, number one, we knew what was on the schedule at Willie J's, the bar right down the street. Mm-hmm. We knew that Sundays and Mondays were 25-cent wing nights, and we knew that Tuesdays and Wednesdays were 250 pizzas. Because we went there Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And then we would go to Oliver's on Thursday.
Yeah.
Shout out to Jose.
Yeah. And that's just with my, and for me personally, that's just with my coworkers. Yeah. Yeah. That's not like in my personal life with my friends where I'd be going out with them. And it just, and I look back at that and go, there were fucking times where I was like rage drinking 6 days a week.
Oh, yeah.
And just being like, and that's to me is, and please feel free, like, because I'm just speaking about myself here. Like, to me, rage drinking is like you're drinking to get fucked up 6 days a week. Like, it's not drinking to take the edge off of things. Like, you are drinking to blackout 6 days a week.
That was the only way I drank.
Yeah.
And I loved it. I loved it.
And I can, for me, though, like, because I feel like, listen, when I used to, in my 20s, like, I've talked on the show, Jamie, about my, like, my struggles with depression. Mm-hmm. And what did I do when I was in my late teens and early 20s? Me and my friend, we all did drugs.
Yeah.
Because that's what we were just trying to numb ourselves.
Yeah.
Because being
numb. Yeah, yeah, but being numb felt better than feeling at that point. And that sucks. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's why I sold weed legally.
But that's why I'm glad it's legal, because as I told Rem, like, weed saved my fucking life when I was, like, in my late teens and early 20s.
Yeah.
You know, because it didn't make me numb, but it basically, like, this is how I describe it.
Made it tolerable.
My mind, I have a very loud mind. I don't know, does that make sense to you? Yes. Like, my mind's always going.
Yeah.
And when I would smoke the right strain, it would
shut up.
My mind would just go like, shh. Mm-hmm. And I would still feel, but that was great. Like, thank fucking God. Like, thank a higher power that, like, I just fucking, like, my mind quiets down for like an hour.
I think if you're going to do drugs or you want to do something recreationally, I think marijuana is the way to go.
Mm. Yeah.
It's not health-wise. It's probably your healthiest option. And, man, no one's going home beating their wife or fucking crashing their car, getting too high. You're just going to eat a lot and fall
Exactly.
asleep.
If you're like me, if you're like me, you're going to grab a fucking can of Chef Boyardee and a bottle of Frank's Red Hot.
Pour those two motherfuckers together.
And then you're going to lose track of time and how much Frank's Red Hot you've been pouring. And then you sober up real quick once you take that first bite.
Yeah, because you put in half a bottle.
Yeah.
You still finish that bowl.
Exactly.
Yeah, but then,
I still sucked it up.
I was going to say, you sit with it and you're like, no, that wasn't that bad. You say that every bite. But
that's some crying through tears.
But I guess, like, you know, that's the difference between being a child and being a man is observing when the behavior becomes detrimental and knowing to step off the track that you're on.
Yeah. I always say perspective. That's what life gives us, perspective. Nothing is a better gift than perspective.
So I have a question for you guys. I'll start with you, Jamie. Right now, you go through a time loop and you bump into 21-year-old Jamie. What do you say to him? Same question for you, Bob, so ponder it.
You're not a piece of shit. No, everyone's not better than you. You're worth it. You're not too old to try new things or to try to get healthy. And, you know, live for yourself. Don't seek validation in others.
You can't say anything better than that.
No.
And it's okay for things to be a mystery. Like, you don't need the answer to everything. Just live by the day, you know?
Yeah, that's a good question, Rem.
Yeah.
I have a thing. I was watching Hot Ones last night, and I like Hot Ones.
I do, too.
Not to try to advertise for other pods or shows.
I have no problem with that.
Huge critique.
Hey, Sean.
I'm so sick of Sean Evans with his fucking hands, dude. Wash his fucking hands when you watch this shit. Stop moving your fucking hands, bro. Because I'm looking down at my hands. I'm like, I feel like, what's his face? Talladega Nights, Ricky Bobby. Oh. It's like, I don't know what to do with my hands. But, dude, the hand movements. I was starting to get annoyed.
Yeah.
And the celebrities taking these small bites. Mm. I respect it. Take the big bite, dude.
Paul Rudd, Matt Damon, a couple of them did it right. Like, ate the fucking
way. I was watching Dinklage last night. He was taking big bites.
Yeah. My favorite.
Sorry, go.
My favorite's Conan.
Yeah.
Because Conan was taking a big butt, but he was hurting.
Yeah.
And ever after a moment, it was literally just like, go fuck yourself.
Yeah, eat that shit. I watched Jaylen Brown last week, and Jaylen Brown was taking the smallest bites and acting like it was the hottest thing he's ever eaten. It's like, bro.
Well, the people who drink from the bottle, I'm like,
All right, I have an idea, guys.
What's that?
We do a Hot Ones episode with hot wings, and we try to do a whole hour.
You can order the season pack.
That's what I'm saying. Let's do it. And we'll do a Hot Ones episode. And we'll see if we can stay and not, like, die.
You can tell I'm out of the young demographic, though, because I'm, like, trying to explain to you this ubiquitous TV show. Hey, dude, do you know? Like, they say it 5 times an episode that you can get this shit.
I've been doing that to people for years, so it's okay.
And then, that's that Xenio shit where you're like, no, I know everything.
Yeah,
exactly. I've got this.
You know, kids, there's this thing called the Hot Ones on YouTube.
Plus, let's say this. Everyone wants to suck Sean Evans' dick for his questions, but he just has a really good team. Who fucking deep dive. That's all it is.
What is so great about his questions?
He'll be like, in the third grade, Mrs. Nordstrom said your ruler was too short and it changed your life. They'll always have this one thing where he talked to one of his, like, friends from grade school. Telling you, bro.
I know. But this is the typical question I think of. What is it like to be an actor? Like, wow. Look at that. Laying it up with a balloon.
Ooh. There's not a lot to say to those people, really.
Yeah, but otherwise, I think it's a great concept. That's why it's gone so well, and I love that show. So, Jamie, one thing I was going to ask you related to something you said earlier about, like, with, you know, where your path is going now and where you can be around people. Like, if they want to fish, you can fish and do that. Mm-hmm. Are those things that you are starting to embrace now in your life to, like, do instead, like, kind of helping to change your life?
You know, going back to my last couple of years, I was in such a dark place. I was just completely isolated. So I haven't really been doing much. I haven't really had hobbies. So it's like kind of like taking a step back and trying new things. You know, I bought a mountain bike, went riding with one of my old, like, high school friends. I haven't hung out with him in so long. It was really fun.
Remember when I got on your mountain bike that day?
He dumped that shit.
Within 2 minutes, bro. Shredded my leg. It was fucking just a bloody scab for like 3 weeks. Dude, I was on the bike for 2 seconds. Because it was just too fucking tall, bro. He didn't warn me that it was at like a need to balance level. So I went to put my feet down. They didn't touch the ground. And brat da da, bro. Brat ga 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 ga, bro. Brat ga 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 ga, bro.
But yeah, dude, I'm just trying new things. I'm down for whatever, honestly. I'm busy, though. I was really, you know, I was kind of talking shit about my ex, but she's really good. She's a good mom. Mm-hmm. And, dude, 50-50 custody, it's great. So I have my kids.
I hate that bitch. Yeah,
she's cool. Shout out to her. She's a great mom. And, you know, some things just don't work out in life.
Amen, brother.
I'm not going to walk through life with a resentment towards her.
I like that.
We had a lot of good memories and things are great. But
bitches be cray.
Yeah, whatever. She's on her own path. You're going to do just fine. But, yeah, dude, I have my kids, so it's, you know, I have them Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. So I work Monday through Friday, so that basically leaves me with, like, Sundays, and I just do whatever I want. And, you know, that's really nice.
Yes.
So the silver lining of the whole situation is I have a few days a week to myself, and that's when I can really do some soul searching. You know, I do a lot of boring stuff. I read, you know. I like silence, you know.
Thank you.
It was lonely at first, and then I was speaking to a friend, and she was like,
"This is great.
It's not loneliness. It's silence."
Yes.
And embrace that. That's a good time for growth, you know. Sometimes I even do a little yoga, like my fat ass. Break the mat out. Yoga by Adrian on YouTube, dude. Fire.
Really?
I swear to God, it's fire, dude.
I fucked around with Yoga by Adrian.
Dude. It's relaxing, and again, it helps you center yourself. Prayer and meditation is wonderful, and again, like, don't get wrapped up on the God thing. You know what I'm saying? It's just a higher power. We all need to find a way to get rid of our negative energy.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You need to release that, because all negative energy does is it creates more problems for you. It can create health problems, and it's just. You need to find a way to get rid of it, whatever that is. And a lot of times people do run to substances to numb it, but you're not getting rid of it.
Yeah.
So you need healthy ways to do it, whether that be exercise or meditation or reading or whatever. Do you burn a fucking candle? I don't know, dude.
I had a friend.
Play Tetris.
Yeah, dude.
I have a friend, and he doesn't hit me up as much, but he used to hit me up every Friday or every Saturday. I just wanted to go out to a bar, and I just try to explain to him, like, I'm around people every day of the week. Mm-hmm. and I don't like I have a so like I have a battery. Like I have a social battery, and that thing is fucking drained by Friday. And that's why I said, so don't ask me on a Friday, because that's like I'm recharging. And then half the time I'm like, don't ask me on a fucking Saturday either. And he's like, well, what do you like to do? And I said, do you know what my favorite two moments of the day are? And he was like, when? And I said, but right before I go to sleep, because I still stay up until like midnight, like because of how quiet it is. I could open a fucking window and it's just quiet. And early in the morning when it's quiet and everything is just still. And I, and he was like, and he goes, oh, I could see that. Cause he's got children too. And he said, well, yeah, when the kids are asleep, like those are the quiet. And I go, and you want to damage my quiet by taking me to like a bar where there's probably going to be like a shitty, like live singer. And there's just like obnoxious younger people. And I guess, yes, I'm also feel like we're at that age too, where I feel like the old fogey, like, fuck off my lawn, you know, but like,
for real though.
You know, I don't like, and I'm just trying to tell him like, it's like sensory overload. Like, I can't do that stuff anymore. And it makes me angry. And I was like, so you want me to go out to be angry? And it's like, no, I just want to go. Then go. I'm like, sometimes I'm like, just go by your fucking self. Yeah. You don't need me. You don't need a fucking wingman for what? So you don't feel awkward drinking by yourself. You could, you do that at home. Just stay at home. And that's, and like, I'm just like, why do you, I said to him, why do we need to go out to drink to hang out?
Yeah.
And he didn't really have an answer for me. Like, I was like, dude, you could just invite me over for a fire in your backyard.
Watch a fucking movie or something.
Just
shit.
Hear the sound of the fire crackling and talk. I was like, I would much rather do that.
It's all you know type thing.
Yeah.
You know, and it's, there's so many other things to do than just go sit in a bar. And that comes with age too. What I really enjoyed about entering my 40s is that I'm starting to get that not giving a fuck about certain things, you know?
It gets bigger.
It's about finding peace. And it's just about like this. I just want to be at ease. And yeah, to sit in a room just being loud, that's not fun to me anymore. Mm-hmm. And dude, we were just talking about this the other day. We went out to eat and it was like, man, I don't even get younger people. I don't. Mm-hmm. And we were talking to the waiter and we were like, I was like, I used to be so funny. Like, I was, like, talking to the hostess at first, and I was, like, trying to crack a joke.
Nothing.
And I'm like, wow, that's so weird. So we call the kid over. He's probably, like, 19, 18, 19.
Yeah.
And I explained to him, I'm like, yo, man, I used to be funny. Like, you...
It was weird, dude.
I can't pop you young kids at all, dude. You guys are just... And, like, Remy's, you can take over for me. He said the most fucking ridiculous thing, and it worked.
You want a gift card? I don't know what to do.
No. We got one, actually. But, no, I said I work with them, and they have this weird soup. It's called brain rot. Their comedy is brain rot. It has no basis in anything that's funny. It's just random. Mm-hmm. And so I said before the guy came over, I'm like, they're weird. Like, they think baseball hats without brims are hilarious. And he's like, what? And I'm like, I don't know. They just do, right? So the guy, so he's talking to the waiter, and he's like, so, like, what do you guys think is funny? And he's like, I don't know. Me and my friend, they don't even know how to answer you. They're so fucking, like, dissociated from society. And so I'm like, what about a baseball hat that had no rim? And he's like, oh.
Like, it fucking worked. The bit fucking worked, dude. I was shocked.
I looked at him, amazing. I said, what'd I tell you, bro? It's so insane because it's not, because our generation's humor is witty and situational.
Yeah.
We play off the situation. Like when he said it at the restaurant.
With that equal mix of dark.
100%.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we go in there, right? We walk into this restaurant and they're like, Kevin, we need a Kevin. Two for Kevin. Where's Kevin? And so Jamie gives his name at the front. He's like, I'm Jamie, but you can call me Kevin. And she's like, Jamie or Kevin? Like she didn't get the fucking joke. And I just, like, saw the wind go out of Jamie's sails. I'm like, bro, it ain't what it used to be.
Yeah, usually a stupid comment and a little smile usually works.
But, yeah, that would usually go a long way.
No, now they're like, they're a weird generation. But what I say about that is, but that's how our parents at 40 and 50 thought about us at that age. Yep.
Yeah.
Because we were saying shit like fucking, I don't even know, like, oh, that's bad and bad was good. Like,
yeah, yeah.
So I just think it's generational and we're finally out of touch officially.
I like it.
I like it and I don't. I like it because I like where it means that I'm at. Yeah. But I miss being hilarious.
Somebody,
I know you do, bro.
Somebody over...
I used to be funny.
So when I did work there, I did work with Gen Zers and Gen Yers, and they would be like, oh, did you hear about the latest influencer who died? And I'd be like, well, no, because I don't follow influencers. And they were like shocked at that. Like, why? It's like, oh, because I live in the real world.
Well, I would have. You know what I would have gotten him with? Oh, cool. Every time an influencer die, an angel gets into him.
Tinkerbell gets a little more powerful.
Yeah, exactly.
Who's Tinkerbell? I'm like.
I literally had to block somebody on YouTube the other day because my daughter, she's going to be 5. Mm-hmm. And, but, you know, she can operate YouTube and stuff. And she starts talking about the difference between rich people and poor people. And she was like, I want to be rich. And she's like, and I'm like, having money doesn't make you a good person. She's like, yes, it does. She's like, I'll never want to be a poor person. I said, who taught you that? And it was some chick named Rebecca. I was like, click. Listen, you'll never see her again.
Listen, Rebecca.
Yeah, Rebecca Zamolo, you little bitch.
Yeah, you're teaching the wrong ethics to an idiot, right?
Like, that's the Mr. Beast effect of like, I got famous, I got all this, I'm going to spread the wealth and all that. And you're all going to be, it's like,
no, it's a God complex. He's in the middle. He's just in the middle handing out chocolate bars and building wells. And I mean, it's great that he's building wells and shit, but like, no, the world's fucked. We are finally at that point in Idiocracy where it's so fucked that we're just going to stand back and laugh. There's not a lot we can do. We can live well. We can be good to those in our circle and we can make righteous choices, but it's fucked.
All right. So is there anything else that we want to talk about?
No, I feel like the episode, that's exactly what we just did, is exactly what we do best. We just exist. And Jamie, what would you, is there anything else on your mind, man? Anything else you'd like to bring up? Anything else you'd like to talk about?
I can't think of anything.
Yeah, I'll put you on the spot. Well, you know, we can do this again, man. We'd like to have you if you'd
come
back.
Come back.
Yeah, and I would love to have you back. We would love to have you back, and thank you for coming on and being you.
Jamie, we did want him for the Puff Daddy episode because this motherfucker knows hip-hop, like, remarkably well. But as you heard, he has a lot going on in his fucking life. But we can revisit that topic if you'd like at some point.
We can talk about Sean Combs.
Yeah.
No. You know what I just fucking found out?
Yes.
Do you guys know why he's called Diddy?
We do now, but...
No, this is not a joke.
He's setting this up.
No, this is real.
The Notorious B.I.G. came up with that nickname.
Diddy Kong.
What the fuck is that?
Come on, man. You serious?
Diddy Kong? Is that like a...
Listen, Kong? Don't try to be funny.
Did you say Kong or Kong?
Diddy Kong. Donkey Kong, right? Donkey Kong Country. The little bitch that follows him around. The little monkey is named Diddy.
I don't believe it.
Oh, 100%. I just saw the guy, Diddy's bodyguard.
Just saw it on fucking YouTube, guy. It has to be true.
Just so you guys know, this little dick motherfucker will never be on the show
Very
again.
Very tiny hands.
Look at the size of the vapes he smokes.
This dink.
Christ.
Rem, I do have to say, yesterday, I was having a little correspondence through YouTube with someone who watched the episode.
Yeah.
And no. It was civil. I was civil. I could tell they're really into cinema.
Yeah.
So they really were just focusing on how we took liberties with Eyes Wide Shut.
What liberties?
So they were saying that, I forget his name, but the person who worked with Kubrick on his last 5 films, he actually got credit for the red guy, the red cloak guy.
Okay.
But he wasn't in the film.
Okay.
It was just one. He said that, you know, he did an interview and he linked me to it and I watched it. Yeah. And he said that, no, that is the final cut. That is Stanley Kubrick's final cut. I didn't really, I just said, thanks. Hey, do you know if this, and he linked me to it, and I said, thanks. But I was like, but okay, but like, we were just trying to draw a parallel between Stanley Kubrick making a film about a fucked up world that now is a reality.
That's been revealed. Yeah.
Like, it wasn't like, okay, thanks. Thanks, film major.
And the survivor, though, who confirmed that this is this collaborator, right, of Stanley Kubrick, that said this was the final cut. Wouldn't he say that?
I think he would too. Yeah.
If Kubrick was exposing some dark forces.
Yeah, he doesn't want to get killed either.
So of course he's going to say that. Guys, listen.
This is it.
Everything is professional wrestling, okay? Everything's a fucking storyline. I missed out on the episode last year, but I'll be fucking damned if Jamie Stewart's missing the next professional wrestling thing.
Oh, yeah.
I will show you guys correlations throughout life. What the fuck do you think Donald Trump's doing right now? Okay.
Playing the heel.
He is fucking a professional wrestler.
Masterfully.
He's literally in the WWE Hall of Fame.
The guy is
working the crowd, dude. He knows what he's doing. He even has Hulk Hogan chilling for him.
Not a Trump fan, by the way.
Holy shit.
Don't misinterpret this.
And fuck Kamala Harris, too, that phony broad. Hey, I'm not voting for anybody because I'm an asshole, all right? There we go.
That's what me and Bob always say. We're non-denominational.
I tell them my sign on my imaginary like front lawn is fuck them both, 2000, whatever it is.
Yep.
Whatever we're
in. Listen, we're powerless over what's going to happen, guys, okay? It doesn't matter who you're voting for. This is a divide and conquer technique, okay? They're doing this as the actual real puppeteers. Shout out to the World Economic Forum. Shout out to Klaus Schwab and those motherfuckers, okay? That's what's really happening. And what they do is they divide and conquer us. They've been doing this shit from the beginning of time. It started in America after they fucking freed the slaves. They started with the lower middle class and poor white people scaring them about the black folks. And then they fucking were like, ooh, let's split people by religion. That works.
Criminalized marijuana just to arrest black and Mexicans.
Dude, it's all in the game plan. Look back to the 70s, dude. They're running the same fucking storylines on the news that they were back then. Nothing has changed in 50 years. They're just dividing us. There's nothing we can do. Create your own little peace in your little part of the world. Fuck what other people are feeling, okay? Fuck it.
On that note, bro.
Find peace. Center yourself. All right? And holla at me. I'm fucking single now, dude. Listen, I just want to make friends, you know? I'm ready to take on the world. Listen, I'm not that desperate. I don't want you to scream at me in a metal voice. That would fucking freak me out, dude. But anyways, this has been so fun. And I'd really like to come back sometime and shoot this
shit. Come on whenever you want, as Remy gives you Frank Reynolds. So anyway, I started blasting. Yep. See? Yeah, and so on that note, I think it's a great note to jump off on. Thank you for everyone who always checks in. And Jamie, thank you very much for coming on. Always a pleasure.
Having you here, buddy.